No doubt that big data analysis leads to winning strategies. And behind the scenes, our next speaker has developed winning strategies for global brands like Nike, Unilever, and Amazon, and has also consulted 25 of the Fortune top 500 companies, starting a $3 multi-million business from scratch, later acquired by Wire and Plastic Products. Welcome on stage a startup investor and marketing advisor, Igor Boyka.
Hello, good afternoon. Can you all hear me okay? In the back as well? I will try not to talk so loud because of the fashion TV party. I know that some people have a headache, but might be I have a small note. Very important. Today I want to talk to you about big data and in the setting of brands and media owners. Of course, the changes in the world driven by data will change a lot of things, and I want to show and share my experience with you today, what I've seen the last 10 years, how it has been changing, what the impact of big data is on brands, on agencies, and on media owners, and how this pushes them in a different position in the value chain. And also my story is about big campaigns, what a lot of brands have been using. How do you turn big campaigns into data-driven, integrated digital marketing? And remember the word integrated, because that's where a lot of companies fail in everything, so also in big data, because we all have our own departments with our own budgets, and we don't want to work together, and that's a problem, because we have silos, and that happens in almost every corporate company, and that's why it's so difficult to create an integrated approach, also in big data. If you want to tweet, hashtag seeds or at Igor Boyka, I try to make it as fast as I can, because I have 6 chapters which I want to discuss with you. Something short about trends in technology that are shaking up all industries. I know a lot of brands says, yeah, but in retail or in travel or in my industry, no, also in your industry, every industry. If you think not in my market, yes, it is happening across all markets. Everybody is going to have its turn, and it might take a while, but trust me. Then something about the barriers. Why don't we use big data? Why is it so difficult? It's not difficult at all. That's bullshit. The American television already shows for 15 years the statistics of every football and basketball player in the world. You can immediately buy him. You can immediately predict if he's going to score the goal or not, all based on big data. And we are telling each other for 10 years that it's all so difficult. No, it's not. It's very simple. And I will explain you why it's so simple, and even more important, why you should be doing this. Because it will make you much more smarter than the competition, so that you can grow or survive your business. Well, that might sound like sense of urgency, right? Surviving your business or growing your business. I don't know more important topics in any industry. Data-driven brands and media, some steps to data heaven. The first steps, if you are convinced by this story and you want to start tomorrow, might happen that a few people say, sounds nice. What are the first steps and how to do it? Because there is a lot of data. You've seen it in the previous presentations as well. Where do you start? I'm not going to talk about technology, so if I'm disappointing to a lot of people, the tech conference is in the other room. Well, what's happening? We're living in a digital world. We all know that. But what does that mean? All the corporate companies have now competition with innovative, agile, data-driven, new technology firms. And now comes the most important one, companies that have no legacy. Free spirits, like Uber. It was never like this before. No, said Uber, but it should have been like this already for 5 years. We are going to build it. And that's what is very difficult for traditional companies. Alibaba is the most valuable retailer in the world, and they have no inventory. Facebook is the most popular media owner in the world and they create no content. Strange, if you're a newspaper or a content platform, suddenly the biggest media owner in the world creates no content. You create the content. And you also give them all your data, so they don't need the NSA and they don't need the CIA. They just say to you, why don't you provide us with all your data? And you know what you all say? What do you want to know? We'll give you everything. Now, there's big data. You. Uber, already talked about it. Other fun thing, Airbnb. No marketing at all, or a little marketing. Smart platform, they own no real estate. And they are shaking up the whole travel industry. And if you ask me what was the travel industry doing, what do you think? Creating big TV commercials to shout on TV, look, we are the coolest travel company. And you know what everybody said? No, let's go to Airbnb, bye-bye hotel. Do you really think that you can explain me with my experience that no travel company in the world could have put a few hundred thousand in a box to say to a few creative people, I know booking.com, why don't you build something for me, come up with some ideas for rental homes? No, we were busy making TV commercials, spending a lot of money because we have budget and deep pockets, so let's spend it. Huh? This is how it goes. In the digital world, there is one thing that I'm so happy about big data, it is give you a lot of business opportunities, a lot of trends. And now here it comes, I have to look at my note. Yeah, this is what I wanted to say. Facebook, Google, huh? Nice, cute technology companies, huh? We all thought, ooh, wow, nice. Do you see them smiling? It's like an ad for Shark Week. Because they will bite and kill you. And we all said, oh, it's so nice, Facebook and Google technology company. No! Media companies masquerading as technology companies. They make every single dollar in media. And why is that so important? They are deconstructing the whole media industry. They are demolishing every media owner. They are disintermediating the media agencies because they go to clients direct. They are not cute technology companies. But that's what we've been thinking for 10 years. And this is our social strategy for a lot of brands and CMOs. I've been a global strategy director in the WPP network. I worked with the largest brand on this planet. You know what the social strategy was? Mine is bigger than yours. Especially the guys, mine is bigger than yours. Let's buy some more fans and followers. Wow, you have an awesome social media strategy. We buy and bribe friends. Cool. Come on, people. If that is a big data strategy, buying friends, no. And for screen agents and digital, I've been showing this slide forever, and people say, yeah, yeah, but what has it got to do with changing business? What do you think? From all the selfies, there is now lingerie companies, a competitor to Victoria's Secret, that from a selfie can distract your bra size, and you can immediately order the bra in the same size. Suddenly, all the funny stuff becomes business, making money. Oh, selfies, it's a funny joke for millennials. Or Alibaba, Jack Ma is presenting it here. Suddenly the selfie is the most used thing in two generations. Millennials, but also Generation Y and Generation C. And suddenly Alibaba makes it a selfie technology, using it as a payment system. Now it's not fun anymore, the selfie. Now selfie is becoming the new PayPal. And if you think, well, Alibaba, who's Alibaba? Stupid Chinese company. Yeah, 9.3 billion sales, not million, billion dollar in one day. Alibaba, single day, 11/11/2014, $9.3 billion in revenues. You know what a few of my clients say? I don't know, I'm not really sure about e-commerce. Okay, well, I said, do you want flowers or your funeral, or do you want me to do consultancy for you? Yeah, I'm fine, I will write my hours for you, but no, come on, let's get serious. This is also in a data-driven world. We don't see the trends yet. What will this mean? Wearable technology, it's looking for killer apps. You know what it means? That all brands are now going to go beyond the mobile phone. Or you don't have a mobile website and a mobile app yet. Well, what are you waiting for? Yeah, We are not ready yet. No, we are not ready yet. It's the only device, the mobile device, that people have with them all the time. If you're away from a PC or whatever, where you are, wherever you are always on your mobile phone. So that's the most important piece in the value chain, and brands say, yeah, I'm not sure about mobile yet. No, no, you're not. But the other brands are already going beyond mobile. They're making apps for the smartphones now, wearable technology. Talk to Plamen later. Can I see your watch? Half his life is in his watch. If he swims, if he runs, all the data is telling him what he can do and how he should improve. Virtual reality, also a trend. Data, technology, and it was a gimmick for gamers, right? No, not interesting. Oh no. Now suddenly it's the extension for retail, where you can walk in the store and with virtual reality suddenly see more, explore more in a small retail store. You can make it as big as you want. And people can buy it. See, like, buy. Like we forget already in social commerce for 10 years. Where's our strategy in social? See and like. Oh, that's really cool. See it, like it, and then you see a pair of sneakers and stuff, 80,000 likes. But you cannot buy it. See, like, but no buy? No, come on. We have to close the loop in marketing. Data will help us to tell us what people want to buy. And the Internet of Things, very short, it's all about devices and machines that will connect to each other and will connect to the Internet. 50 billion devices by 2020. It might even be 60 billion or 70 billion. Who cares? It's a lot, yeah? Agree? 50 billion is a lot. I call it the Internet of Everything. It's all connected. And we are still doubting about data? Everything is data. In God we trust, and all others must bring data. There is no way out. In every industry, you need to be data-focused. And what are the barriers? Yeah, you're laughing for me. I'm almost crying every day. Because now we get to the sad part. What are the barriers of big data? This. No, don't laugh, please. This is what every corporate company is run by. They're like me, old school guys, gray beard. You know, I'm not so much in technology. I said, no, you. But are you the target group, or are you the one that should be creating stuff that the target group wants? Yeah, then you feel it. Technology resistant. These are the decision makers. And this is their target audience. I can do it back again. One more to see it. These guys decide on what these people are doing. Come on. Yeah, you can clap. And then we're all discussing, yeah, but we need more case studies. And then if we need the case studies, the cat was sick, and then grandma had to go to a home. And there is always something. What I'm trying to say is, you gotta move now, and if you don't move now, you might be dead man walking in a few years' time. This is how fast it goes. The Googles and the Facebooks and the Airbnbs and all the other ones that are shaking up the industry, they're not going to sit and wait for you. Forget it. They are moving in a massive pace. And what are we doing? Waiting. And why and why and why? What do chief marketing officers do? 99 problems, but the bitch ain't one. 99 problems, but big data ain't one. The CMOs are way too busy with a lot of other things. And they are right, because if you're a CMO today, the whole world is changing. Not in a day, not in a week, every day. The only constant is change. So they're talking about the closing stores in retail and technology and showrooming and webrooming and bacon and mobile commerce and there is so many things on their plate that they almost drown. And I already forecasted it in 2012. The chief marketing officer will soon spend more than the chief information officer. Marketing is becoming technology. And why do CMOs dodge data? Why don't they embrace it? This, especially for the ladies. Nice slides. I looked for it for hours. CMOs for 16 years since Procter & Gamble invented this soap, a format on television to sell soap to a housewife. For 60 years, we have been making big commercials and big campaigns. And some celebrity endorsements. Nobody drinks Pepsi, so what do you do? Yeah, then you get Beyonce to say, can you promote Pepsi for me? This is the way how we do marketing. And we think that this is the holy grail in marketing. Still today. No way. What are CMOs doing? The difficulty is that for 60 years we have been doing something and we are still taking legacy thinking, old thinking and old systems. That's what we try to do. And we keep applying them to this new world of innovation. If I'm going too fast and you want to tweet it, just say so and then I reverse it. Sorry. It's difficult for us. And we keep trying it. And you know what? I can tell you, I've seen it, big data implementations at so many leading global brands, it fails and fails and fails and fails all over again. In the new world, there are new rules of engagement. Doesn't work the old shit, copy-paste it to the new world. No, never. So why do you keep trying? I don't know. Without data, maybe not now yet, but if the competition does it, we already have used and we have a serious problem, because if the competition do it, they become much smarter, 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 smarter over time. And without data, we are blind and deaf, like these animals wandering there on the freeway. And you know what will happen with the cute animals? A steak on your plate, because they will be run over by a car or a bus. Bam! And why? Because we think, wow, maybe next year. Yeah, the competition will wait for you. Yeah, next year. You have to have architects. Architects can envision and build cathedrals. Everything else is just bricks in the wall. Don't focus at social media data or clicks or SEO or only on the single stuff, banners or TV. You need to make it integrated. Otherwise, you have blind spots. And what do CMOs do? Some CMOs ask that to me. Igor, I'm not data savvy. What do? I say, propose. Will you, please? CIO, marry me, help me. It's the only way that CMOs can survive in this new generation. Team up with your CIO. Team up and work together on technology. Otherwise, it's not going to work. Trust me, not going to work. So if you don't know it, grab the hand of the one that knows it and work together. Simple integration. The benefits, to me, we have all been looking for always for the big wet marketing dream. Intelligence that gives us the smartest decisions. If I was a 4-star general in whatever army and I wanted to go into Kabul because we're in war or the enemy is attacking, what do you think, that nowadays you can win a war without satellites and intelligence? Oh, let's walk in, we see, maybe there are some guys with a bazooka, let's see, go in. You need the intel. It's the same as in the business life. If you don't have the intelligence, you will make the wrong decisions. And very painful wrong decisions. Why do I love this approach, Jeff Bezos, the CEO from Amazon? Because he has copied the ARPU model into his business, average revenue per user. It is the most predictive company in the world. The telecom companies invented it. What is ARPU? What is the average revenue per user? Because you can easily predict it. Amazon can say to shareholders, listen guys, we have 300 million customers at the moment, which all spend $700 per year. Next year we'll grow 10% in new customers. But be aware, there is no hockey stick. The new customers will spend a little less, only $500 per year. So we will grow, and next year we will grow to 350 million customers. The long-term clients will spend $800-$900 per year, and the new ones, $600. This is the most predictive company in the world. Why? Data, 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 data. Even to shareholders, they can say what they are going to do, what they are going to invest, and how they will become more profitable. And if you look what we all do, we spend a lot of money on media, a lot of money on media. We can do liquid and adaptive media planning. What do I mean by that? If this is the new mix of media, for a lot of companies we invented a new mix. The old mix was only paid, yeah? No matter what, paid advertising, from Google Ads to TV commercials, outdoor, whatever. But now we see and we learn that there is a mix possible. A mix between paid, owned, and earned media. Let's say PR combined with advertising. And if your owned media works, you are capitalizing on your media investment. And if you can earn attention because people talk about your brand, you don't have to buy attention. Buying attention is difficult anyway because nobody nowadays believes advertising. So if you can earn attention, you don't need advertising. And if your advertising works because the sum of paid and earned works, you can amplify what you're doing by making it bigger with advertising. And I think data is the lifeblood of marketing, not only media and advertising, but also of marketing. It will give CMOs mega power. You can win new battles. For example, to switch from an old model where traditional publicity is interruption, look at me, buy me in a TV commercial, to atomic agile content marketing. What do I mean by that? If you're part of Nike Running and you run and you have a profile and you run twice a week, 10 miles, 4 miles, whatever, Nike will send you a personalized video with your name in it and your personal data in it. So if they have hundreds of thousands of runners, they make hundreds of thousands of personalized videos. That is what nowadays is possible with CRM, content marketing, and smart relevant data. If you combine it, I can give you your own video instead of one size TV commercial fits all. So it becomes more relevant, people love it, embrace it, share it, and they stick to the Nike brand. That's why data is so interesting. Data can also save a lot of retailers. Across a lot of markets, 20 to 30% of retail will go broke. You see empty stores in the streets, you see it in London, you see it in Amsterdam, you see it in a lot of major cities. Retail is moving online. A lot of retailers are suffering. What can big data do to help them? What if stores and retail were just as smart as online? That you come in the store and that you get beacons that say, based on your data and CRM, hyper-personalized recommendations and targeted CRM. If you make retail stores as smart as Amazon, people who also bought this and people based on your profile and interest, we serve you different recommendations and products. Where is retail? Data can help them. Data can also make a fitting room where a woman in this example is fitting a dress, where the stock is linked to her size and it says, hey, you're fitting the blue dress. We also have the red dress for you available in size 40. How smart is that? Cross-selling and upselling, like the internet, but now in retail. Is it difficult? No. Does it help? Yes, because you will sell a lot more. And that is what retail needs. Increase your revenues, making it smarter, make clients more loyal so that they come back. And we already saw omnichannel. Omnichannel means that you are combining the smartness with data so that you basically, offline and online, always service the same client with the same smart data and information. Why does it help? Because it's a data-driven marketing intelligence platform across the offline and the online worlds. You can combine it. Now about media, I know a lot of you work in media. Big data will also revolutionize the whole media industry. Because what will happen? TV with data will finally be like the internet. Super targetable, programmatic and addressable. We can now target audiences because we know all about you. We know who you are. Relevant, targeted TV advertising based on your profile, like on the internet. Harnessing data also turns unknown viewers into known members. If you're a broadcasting station, I had recently a client that said, yeah, but Igor, I don't get the problem. We have 6 million viewers every week. So yeah, how many of them do you know out of the 6 million? Okay. That's why you should transform into a sort of Amazon, that you also know who your viewers are, because your advertisers want to know who they are and what their interests are. And with a non-linear data strategy, if you come from the free spirit world and not the old world, TV networks, if they integrate data, might even survive all the Netflix and Spotify and all the other generations, the new companies that do everything based on targeting and your insights on data. They know everything. They already produce series based on your interests and likes. They can already say to a cast, we want you because your audience, our audience wants you. TV doesn't know that. TV says, oh, you didn't like the show. I saw that on social media. What's wrong? We are in a whole different system. Some examples, we already saw that in the forum presentation. Why data is like teenage sex. I don't know if you still remember what you said to your friends when you were younger, but a lot of people tell about big data. We're doing it, but they're not really doing it yet because they're a bit ashamed that it's so difficult for them. All brands are now publishers. Every brand is a publisher. That's changed. We all have apps, we all have content, we have blogs, and we do social media publishing almost every day. So brands are also becoming publishers. I showed you about Nike. What is so smart about Nike? I call it a community, a platform, a data-driven owned media platform. Nike owns this platform. It's always on, 365 days per year you can come here. Even in between campaigns, Nike is relevant. And in 2007, Nike already said, we are not in the business of supporting the media industry, we are in the business of connecting with consumers. Why would Nike keep spending all its money at the publishers where they can build their own media platform? Smart. Investing your media to make a long-term community, so that you are not fully depending on advertising. Well, Red Bull, content is king, distribution is queen, metrics is the emperor. Based on data, Red Bull now creates its own content. They don't need an advertising agency anymore. They also are their own in-house media and distribution company, so they don't need a media agency anymore. Suddenly, they cut agencies out of the value chain. We can do it ourselves. I want to skip this. I had a video on Gatorade. Because of the time, I want to skip it. It's a video that shows you, look it up, how real-time insights in a mission control room enable brands to monitor real-time what is being said and told about your brand. It is a clear, short step how data can help you. The steps to data heaven, from madman to mathman. This is the big change. Yeah, you're laughing. These guys, Don Draper, it's a nice series, Dead Man Walking. No advertising agency will survive if they do not embrace digital and technology and data. It's not going to happen. Yeah, maybe for the few brands that will do a few TV commercials for the coming few years. The last one standing. Data is a made marketing a science, also a science. It used to be an art led by creativity. Data is now also a science. You can get hard, actionable insights. So new marketing is not about the medium, but about relationships, and that's where data helps. If you see, what can you do in a few steps, from unknown to known? Simple steps that you don't target somebody that you don't know, but that you target somebody that you know a lot about. Your interest, your buying behavior, your clicking behavior. And if you want to see this in the handout, there are 7 simple steps to build up customer profiles. Social insights, yes. And most important in number 7, the missing link in now, social and local data. SOLOMO, social, local, mobile. The missing part in data, if I go into a retail store, if I buy something or whatever I do, where I check in or write a review on Yelp, that's the missing part mostly in data. That mobile part is incredibly important. Also nice for the handout, what we did with WPP, we gathered all the data for clients, all. Data from all the media insights, data from all the other platforms, data from third parties, CRM data from the client. You analyze it, you look for the insights, and next you make smarter decisions to improve your marketing and media strategy. So to summarize and close, my key points for today. If you want to survive, let me be clear enough, if you want to survive, embrace data. I think that all brands and media owners that will embrace big data in time will survive. Most, however, will be smaller players in this digital era. Because the new free spirits, the Googles, the Ubers, the Teslas, the Airbnbs and the Alibabas, will keep disrupting our industry. They will be suddenly in our industry and take away a piece from the pie. And I think this is all you. You remember the movie Tom Cruise in Minority Report? Predictive modeling. Based on data, you can predict the future. That's what big data is doing. Big data beats emotions. We are going from madman to madman. Look at Darwin. Only the species that adapts in time will survive. This only also goes for the digital era. If you learn today's trends, like virtual reality, like Internet of Things, and you apply them on time to your business model, you can coin a lot of new business opportunities. Big data will help you to adaptive planning and predictive marketing, be smarter on media, be smarter on marketing. It will enable you to finally compete with the big new players like Facebook, Amazon, and Alibaba. So I said, big data, don't hate, integrate. This is what will happen in the future, I guess. What is the next step? It's the biggest revolution in marketing, big data. Insights, data-driven, integrated digital marketing. The gap is going to be huge. So if you want to jump the gap, you got to move now. Bigger than the internet, the gap. Steve Jobs said, innovation distinguishes between a leader and a follower. What are you? If you're a market leader, you are innovating as one of the first. You don't wait until everybody has already done it. Jeff Bezos, my hero. Oftentimes, invention requires a long-term willingness to be misunderstood. Of course you will fail every now and then. But do you think that little failures in trying are worse than sitting on the sideline and missing the boat? No, you have to keep practicing now. And the end of the topic, be nice to nerds. We will all end up working for one. Thank you very much.